Thank you very much, Kantag. Greetings to everyone. And it's a pleasure to join you all at this moment to share with you about findings of this study. As you rightly said, my name is Sakah Bernard, and I'm talking to you from Yaoundé, Cameroon. And of course, I'd like to thank UN Women for this opportunity to share these findings with you all, and of course, to be able to go in depth into what the situation is as far as Cameroon is concerned. Our discussion for this morning, this afternoon, depending on where you are, would focus, of course, on some harmful social norms and practices, as well as challenges and stigma related to GBV across host communities of the SCE program in Cameroon. And the study was actually conducted in three key regions of the country, that is the Far North region, Adamawa, and the East region of Cameroon, where the SCE program is currently being implemented. And of course, in terms of our discussion, we're going to look at the context briefly, and also we're going to see what the research questions were that guided us in the field. We are going to look into some methodological issues, and also we're going to get into the framework and then findings and analysis of what obtains in the field. And so we would end with some conclusions and, most importantly, recommendations that need to be worked upon. On that note, I would like to recall that this study actually questioned what are some of the harmful social norms, challenges, and stigma that are actually associated with GBV across the SCE project site in Cameroon. And each specific question of this study really looked into what all of those social norms are, what the challenges, and of course, what the stigmas are, and which we actually observed, of course, based on the context that we're working on, that since the year 2014 till date, we have actually been experiencing some serious threats from the Boko Haram terrorist group across the northern part of the country. That includes, of course, the far north, some parts of Adamawa. And also we have witnessed over the past years serious infiltration of movement of refugees from the Central African Republic into the eastern region of the country. And this has actually been exacerbated in the past weeks, even with the elections and tension that is actually prevailing in that country. And again, since 2016, we have actually had a very serious situation in the northwest and southwest region of the country, wherein we are increasingly witnessing internally displaced persons and even refugees out of the country. But all of these situations are actually at the forefront of maybe most, if not some of the cases that we're witnessing as far as GBV is concerned. And this adds to the GBV experiences that we had often had, especially across these concerned regions. And that is why when you look, there is actually an increasing trend of some forms of GBV, including, of course, sexual violence, physical violence, emotional violence. And even when you look at the recent COVID-19 pandemic, GBV as well has increased. And this really calls for concern, especially when you look at the situation of the SCE project across the various sites that we actually conducted this study in. And to be able to arrive at the findings that we are sharing with you at this moment, we had to combine some techniques of qualitative and quantitative methodology so that we are able to get, you know, more in-depth understanding of what the situation is on ground, and to be able also to provide more evidence-based recommendations that we are going to find in the course of this conversation. And we had to also get inspiration in terms of the framework from Lorige's framework, which looks at violence against women. And this is because when you see, it actually looks at violence from a perspective of the individual, the family, the community, and society, which is at the macro level, because the question of violence against women and girls cannot be looked upon from one angle. It has to be looked across from all of these perspectives. And that is why the findings we have are actually going to be considered from the various perspectives, if not dimensions that Laurie tries to discuss as far as this framework is concerned. So it's important to note this, because when you see in terms of even the findings, you also discover that most of the participants that were involved in our study were below the age 50. And also when you look in terms of their marital status, interestingly, 50% of them were married. And when you even go age-wise, you discover that some of those were even married, if not many of them, are below the age of 20, 25. And that also speaks a lot in terms of what the experiences in these regions are concerned. And even when you look from a gender perspective, you notice that more female participants were involved in the study. And this also not because the study strictly focused on women and girls, but excuse me, because actually we noticed that there is still that misperception or misconception of gender as well across the region. And so some of this affects even studies like this when we conduct and try to also get perspectives from the men and boys who are living in these communities. And again, when you look from a, maybe a perspective of education, you also notice that just, you know, below 50% of those who are involved have some basic, you know, education, but then many others do not have any formal education. And these all have implications as far as the livelihood and activities of women across these regions are concerned. And when we see in terms of some of the harmful social norms that are experienced in these regions, the women themselves, they express concerns as far as, you know, experiences with child marriage, forced marriages, denial of resources, sexual violence, domestic violence, you know, all of these which they experience and which continues to render them vulnerable, which continues to expose them to more risk and of course to diverse consequences, some of which have actually rendered them, well, health-wise, really a challenge. And when you look economic-wise, deprivation from resources, increasing their poverty situation, and of course, depriving them from living their dreams, as is the case with their male counterparts. And even when you go further, you notice that some of these social or harmful social norms are actually triggered even by the lifestyle of the men in the region, because some of them actually alluded to the fact that alcohol, drug abuse maybe tends to justify some of their actions towards these women, especially, you know, violent. And when you see even the family experiences of violence, they influence the lifestyle of these children, and most especially, they also even account for some of the violent behavior that children tend to go with, especially the male children or men towards women and girls in the region. And so you also notice even that apart from the history of violence, you see even, you know, mental health issues or some form of trauma, depression, and all of these, which are all in one way accountable for the very painful experiences that women and girls are facing across the regions. And the implications, of course, like I've rightly highlighted, maybe range from mental to physical trauma. You have lack of self-confidence, self-esteem, loss of livelihood. And of course, you also have many of them who tend to be violent. And even some of the women either lost their lives or some of them actually are forced to divorce from their marriages as a result of the violence that they experience. And this is actually very evident when you look at some of the SCE beneficiaries whom living in the host communities have not been able to maybe fulfill their dreams because of marital issues they've had. And you see some of them sharing experiences with regards to the time maybe they got married or they were forced into marriage at the age of 12, some at the age of, you know, 14, 18, and you find them divorcing at the age of 22, 24. So you can imagine how bitter the experience is for some of these girls. And unfortunately, you find out that there is some nexus between religious practices, patriarchy, and even the cultural environment where you have some of these gender, you know, biases and inequalities prevailing in the region. And this explains why, to tackle the issue, of course, we would have to be able to look at all what these different maybe structural issues and, of course, religious and sociocultural environment plays as far as enhancing some of those social norms is concerned. We notice that as far as the implications of, you know, this violence are concerned, women are unable to actually live their full potentials. And that is why you see the situation of poverty, which justifies why some of them have to, you know, fend for themselves through activities like petit trade, which I'm sure are among the very prominent activities in the SEA project. But then you see many of them involved in farming activities. Unfortunately, of course, we discover that they are not able to have all it takes to acquire land for themselves, and of course, to have the necessary capital to start up businesses. And I'm sure these are some of the challenges which the SEA program is trying to address. But then the fact that they are still faced with the men and boys who are so addicted to alcohol, to drug abuse, and of course, who are still, you know, perpetrating the very violent behavior towards them, enhanced and exasperated by the various social, economic, and gender inequalities in the environment, makes it really very challenging for the situation of these women to be involved. And this, again, justifies why we would be able to look at, you know, the various dimensions, economic, social, cultural challenges that these women are experiencing, so that we can have, you know, a more holistic approach to addressing the issue. And one of the important findings, of course, is in line with the available GBV services. Interestingly, many of these women are aware of the services. Unfortunately, many of them don't tend to also solicit the services. And this explains why you see that many of them still rely on family members. Some rely maybe on church groups and maybe neighbors to be able to get services, which of course are not professional enough or which do not meet the necessary standards and quality as should be the case. And so you see even like the women cohesion spaces that we have at the level of Ngam, you notice that they are not fully used by those, you know, for whom it is put at their disposal. And this explains why there is need for so much sensitization to be able to ensure that the services that are available, at least the women and girls, you know, who are victims of GBV can be able to make good use of them. If not, then the challenge continues. And you also notice that in terms of stigmas that we also observed in the field, you find some of these women and girls who tend to be rejected by their families or the community for wanting maybe to challenge some of the harmful social norms they're experiencing. This could be, for instance, those who maybe refuse to get married at a certain early age, you know, and you also notice that some of the men, they feel that educated women and girls are really not good wife material. And so it tends to discourage some of the girls or women from pursuing formal education for fear of not getting maybe husbands at the end of the day. And you notice some of the women and girls who might have survived rape, for instance, some men claim that these women are really not good again as to be married or maybe to get into some relationships. But worst of it is the perception of maybe single women whom some of the men refer to as harlots or prostitutes. And also you find that some men and boys are unable or they feel reluctant to denounce the kind of experiences they have, or maybe abuses, for fear of being considered weak or irresponsible in their communities. And so you notice that while women may tend to also try to access some of the GBV services available in the communities, some of the men who experience abuses may not even do so for all of these stigmas. And that's why some of the girls or women who are maybe single mothers, they also tend to be considered a disgrace in their families. And this really makes it quite difficult for them to live their own dreams as well. And so you find many of the girls, especially those who are involved in this study at age below 25, having already, you know, 2, 3, 4 kids, and most of them also single, but without any major source of livelihood. And this explains to you why poverty remains really a real issue in these regions. And so the laudable initiative of SEE to address some of this. So just maybe in terms of concluding remarks, we noticed that some of these social harmful norms really would continue to prevail if we do not engage holistic and, of course, more stringent measures to be able to address them. But the more difficult part of it is actually the prevailing conflicts we have, the Boko Haram, the Anglophone conflict, the refugees coming in, you know, from Central African Republic, because if all of these are not addressed, it means that we will continue to experience more of these kind of painful experiences for women and girls. And I think the most important thing which we are looking at is the need to consider a multi-stakeholder approach to tackling these GBV issues. And this is the more reason why we notice that we have to leverage on maybe the willingness and readiness of some of these stakeholders, including the government, international actors, local, you know, development actors, NGOs, CEOs, who are willing to be able to bring on board their various contributions towards addressing the prevailing GBV issues. But there is need to have more coordinated action, more systematic, you know, interventions in a way that we do not end up creating more problems rather than addressing those that we want to address. And again, we find that there are obviously specific recommendations that each stakeholder or actor needs to take into consideration. And I think here, the government and political will is really important, as well as being able to mainstream gender and allocate, you know, the necessary budget, as well as provide all that is needed to enhance the work of humanitarian actors, including, of course, service providers. And the partners, I'm sure that you obviously need to continue providing more funding, you know, and also trying to ensure that we have better coordinated interventions that do not end up in some waste of resources, but rather ensure more judicious use of resources to address the problems that we have in the field. And like I've already said, the role of CSOs, NGOs, and individuals cannot be overemphasized, because these are, you know, grassroots actors whose presence, whose daily activities is very important as far as addressing, you know, the daily challenges of women and girls is concerned. And I'm sure that this must be very specific and strategic with respect to the realities that we find on ground. So I think basically these are some of the few highlights we could have from this study. And I look forward to engaging with you all as far as maybe your questions or need for clarifications are concerned. Thank you so much for your kind attention.